system is to provide protection of the host organism from infection. We can subdivide the immune system into the innate immune system that includes complement, lysozyme, interferons, phagocytosis by neutrophils or macrophages. And it is the first line of protection from invading pathogen. And also, our immune system includes adaptive immune system. The subject of pharmacology is to discuss the function of adaptive immune system. It is the next step of protection. It is a more specific immunological response to an invading organism. So that's why we'll speak about the function of adaptive system. So this system provides response to each antigen in a specific manner, discrimination between foreign antigens and self-antigens, response to a previously encountered antigens in learned way, and the specific response of the immune system includes two phases, an induction phase and an effector phase. In turn, effector phase consists of humoral immunity and cell-mediated immunity. For us, this will be very important because some non-selective drugs can inhibit humoral immunity together with cell-mediated immunity. But for example, to prevent rejection of tissues or organs in organ transplantation, it's better to inhibit selectively cell-mediated immunity. Because if in such situation, the drug will inhibit humoral immunity also, so it will inhibit bone marrow suppression. So Farzona and Ali Samar Reda. So 1 minute. Farzona. And Ali Samar Reda. In what group? In what group?
77.
Uh-huh. I will end. You are first. And can you tell me what's your name? Samar?
Samar, yes.
Mm-hmm. Good. So we are speaking about immunodepressants. So on this slide, you can see these two phases, induction phase, it is the beginning of the immune response, and effector phase, when it is the formation of antibodies or release of different cytokines from T helpers 1 or cell-mediated reaction that occurs due to the action of cytotoxic T lymphocytes. So the formation of the response of the immune system to the antigen starts from antigen-presenting cells. Such cells can be macrophages. In general, they're called monocytes. So antigen-presenting cell passes information to two types of T lymphocytes, CD4 and CD8. So after differentiation of this TCD4, it will be the formation of cellular immunity and humoral immunity. And differentiation of CD8 to cytotoxic T lymphocytes provides cell-mediated reactions. So let's speak about differentiation of T lymphocyte CD4. First, it is the formation of T helper 0, polypotent cells. After this, it is differentiation of these polypotent cells to T helpers 2. activated T lymphocytes release interleukin 4, and this is key factor that is responsible for formation of humoral immunity, because first of all it will be differentiation of T helpers to B lymphocytes, then it will be the phase of proliferation of B cells, and then it will be differentiation of B cells to plasmocytes, and in turn plasmocytes synthesize antibodies. And second differentiation reaction from polypotent cells is the T helpers 1 differentiation. Activated T helpers 1 release interleukin 2. So it will be proliferation of T helpers 1, and these cells are responsible for cellular immunity. So in the end, in effective phase, T helpers 1 release macrophages activating cytokines, interleukin 2, immune interferon gamma, and other cytokines. So, and on this diagram, different immunotropic drugs connect. So, today we must discuss the drugs that inhibit immune responses. These drugs are called immunodepressants or immunosuppressants, and the drugs which stimulate immune system. Old name of this group, immunostimulants, modern immunomodulating drugs. Inhibition of immune response is required when adaptive immune system fails to distinguish self tissues and foreign antigens. This results from activation of self-reactive T and B lymphocytes generating cell-mediated or humoral immune responses. Cell-mediated T, B lymphocytes, humoral immune responses. And this response is directed against self-antigen. Normally, immune system is tolerant to self-antigens, but in abnormal reaction, it will be response against self-antigens. And such pathological conditions underlie development of variety of autoimmune disorders. So the first indication for the usage of immunosuppressant is to treat autoimmune disorders. So in autoimmune disorders, we must inhibit the immune response, the response of immune system to these self antigens. Immunosuppressants in general are used in except autoimmune disorders to prevent transplant rejection in organ transplantation, to suppress graft versus host disease in bone marrow transplants. So the main drawback of immune suppression is the hazards of decreased defenses against infectious pathogens. So when we use immunodepressants, it will be increased susceptibility to infections. So, and the second disadvantage of immune suppression is the risk of emergence of malignant cells. So classification of immunosuppressive drugs. So cytotoxic drugs can be divided into antimetabolites and alkaline agents, cyclophosphamide. Antimetabolites, azathioprine, methotrexate, so it will be enough to remember. Glucocorticoids, prednisolone and dexamethasone will be enough to remember. And you must also remember that glucocorticoids can't be used alone as immunosuppressants. Only together with other immunosuppressants, for example, with inhibitors of interleukin-2 synthesis or with cytotoxic drugs. Third group, inhibitors of interleukin-2 synthesis and action I will remind you that this group of drugs, because of inhibition of interleukin 2, has predominant effect on the cellular immunity. If we are speaking about glucocorticoids, they inhibit expression of interleukin 2 and interleukin 4. That's why glucocorticoids have immunodepressant effects on immune cellular system and also on the humoral immunity. But in general, glucocorticoids have predominant action on cellular immunity. If we are speaking about cytotoxic drugs, they inhibit both humoral and cellular immunity. So that's why they will cause serious adverse effects. So inhibitors of interleukin 2 synthesis and action. Calcineurin inhibitors. Calcineurin is the phosphatase enzyme. So from this group of drugs, you must remember by heart cyclosporin. Tacrolimus, sirolimus 3 is the option. If you have good memory, you can remember the names of such drugs. So interleukin 2 receptor signaling mTOR inhibitor, sirolimus or everolimus, polyclonal antibodies, anti-thymocyte antibodies. So again, these drugs act directly on the cellular immunity, because this is the formation of antibodies against T lymphocytes, and monoclonal antibodies to the receptors of interleukin 2, basiliximab. So nowadays, the modern direction of synthesis of new drugs is the synthesis of monoclonal antibodies. So anti-CD20 rituximab or ofatumumab, these drugs cause beta cells depletion because they bind with the CD20 protein that is localized on the membrane of B cells, and after binding, it will be the death of beta cells. So these drugs predominantly act on the humoral immunity. Anti-alpha-4 integrin, or in another word, adhesion molecule inhibitor, natalizumab. Anti-CD25, interleukin 2 receptor antagonist, basiliximab. So this drug has predominant action on the cellular immunity. Cytotoxic drugs, they are old group of immunodepressants, and these drugs are used until nowadays. So cytotoxic agents are used for immunosuppression as well as for anti-neoplastic chemotherapy. Two classes of cytotoxic agents. Anti-metabolites, so these drugs are structural analogs of natural metabolites that inhibit essential pathways involving these metabolites. So these anti-metabolites incorporate into the DNA and stop replication of DNA and then stop cell division. Alkylating agents interfere with DNA replication and gene expression, because these drugs bind covalently by alkyl groups to DNA. So by this mechanism, they prevent separation of DNA chains that are required for DNA replication. So as a result of this mechanism, these drugs stop DNA replication and stop cell division, because if there is no separation of DNA, it can't be synthesis of new DNA and can't be synthesis of mRNA as the base for the synthesis of new proteins, structural or physiological as enzymes. Therapeutic goal in both anti-neoplastic chemotherapy and immunosuppression is the elimination of undesirable cells. So it was a fact. So these drugs are non-selective against cellular and humoral immunity. So the target for their action are the rapid dividing cells. For example, these cells are cells of the blood. That's why it will be bone marrow suppression, leukopenia, anemia, thrombocytopenia. Also, epithelial cells of gastrointestinal tract belong to rapid dividing cells. So it will be nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. And don't forget that hair also belongs to rapid dividing cells with the rapid growth. So that's why it will be alopecia. Activating agent cyclophosphamide. As I have already said to you, this drug stops DNA replication. Because cyclophosphamide has a major effect on B cell proliferation, so the use of cyclophosphamide in immune diseases is limited to disorders of humoral immunity. So this drug can be used to treat autoimmune disorders such as systemic lupus erythematosus, I don't know, sclerodermia, and so on. And also suppression of antibody formation against xenotransplant graft. And don't forget, also in different types of cancer. For example, breast cancer or lymphomas, and so on. And don't forget, adverse effects, rapid dividing cells. Leukopenia, cardiotoxicity, alopecia, and also if we are trying to use them, for example, to treat autoimmune disorder, it will be increased risk of cancer because of mutagenicity. Antimetabolites, azathioprine, it is the prodrug of antimetabolite 6-mercaptopurine. Mercaptopurine is formed by the cleavage of azathioprine in a non-enzymatic reaction with glutathione. The slow release of 6-mercaptopurine from azathioprine favors immunosuppression. Azathioprine has a longer duration of action and because it is a prodrug and is more immunosuppressive than mercaptopurine. While 6-mercaptopurine itself is more useful as an anti-neoplastic drug. So next, antimetabolites that belong to cytotoxic drugs, methotrexate. It is a folate analog used since the 1950s to treat malignancies. It is used also in autoimmune disorders, to which belong rheumatoid arthritis. And this drug possesses not only immunosuppressant, but also anti-inflammatory effect. So also in rheumatoid arthritis, gold standard therapy is used. And you can add to gold standard therapy methotrexate. Psoriasis, the skin disorder, also is an indication for the usage of methotrexate and for the prevention of graft versus host disease. So, anti-inflammatory activity is due to increased adenosine levels. Adenosine is the potent endogenous anti-inflammatory mediator that inhibits neutrophil adhesion, phagocytosis, and superoxide generation. So that's why if it possesses so many beneficial effects as anti-inflammatory mediator, it's better to increase its concentration. And methotrexate can do this. Leflunomide are also anti-metabolite drug. If you want, you can remember the name of this drug according to mechanism of action. It is an inhibitor of dehydroorotate dehydrogenase. It is the key enzyme in the synthesis of UAMP pyrimidine synthesis. Of nucleic acid. So this drug can be used to treat autoimmune disorders. And again, you see adverse effects include rapid dividing cells, destruction, diarrhea, epithelial cells of GIT, and reversible alopecia. Glucocorticoids, next, the immunodepressant group. So targets for the action of glucocorticoids are intracellular receptors. So steroids cross cell membranes inside the cytoplasm. They bind together with their own cytoplasmic receptors. Then complex glucocorticoid, or here is steroid molecule, together with receptors, go into the nucleus, and in the nucleus, steroids eliminate from the binding with the receptors, and they can stimulate gene transcription or inhibit gene transcription. Here you can see stimulation of gene transcription with the synthesis of mRNA, and on the basis of mRNA will be the synthesis of protein. Here can be synthesis of protein that belong to structural proteins, or these proteins can be enzymes. So these glucocorticoids can be used not alone, but in combination with other drugs in organ transplantation to prevent rejection, and plus in autoimmune disorders. Calcineurin inhibitors, cyclosporine and tacrolimus. Almost the same mechanism of action, but inside T lymphocytes, cyclosporine binds with calcineurin, it is phosphatase, and tacrolimus, cyclosporine binds with cyclophilin, and this complex cyclosporine-cyclophilin inhibits calcineurin activity. And tacrolimus inside T lymphocytes binds together with its own FK protein. So tacrolimus chemical name FK 506. So that's why tacrolimus inside T lymphocyte binds with FK binding proteins. And then this complex tacrolimus of K binding proteins inhibits also calcineurin. And then the mechanism becomes the same for cyclosporine and tacrolimus. But in general, we can speak about more efficacy for tacrolimus. You see, it is generally 50 to 100 times more potent versus cyclosporine. So you will read by yourself for the detail about mechanism of action. I will explain you on the base of the diagram. So inside T lymphocyte, cyclosporine rectangle binds with cyclophilin protein, and tacrolimus inside T lymphocyte binds with FK binding protein, gray. So after this, complex of cyclosporine with cyclophilin binds with calcineurin. It is phosphatase enzyme. So, and when cyclosporine with cyclophilin binds with calcineurin, calcineurin can't be activated. But if we take situation without drugs, for example, here, what will be in normal conditions? So inside T lymphocytes, when will be activation of them, this activation provides increased calcium concentration inside cells. So increased concentration of calcium binds with calmodulin, then this complex calcium calmodulin binds to with calcineurin, and calcineurin becomes active. After this, this calcineurin, or in another words, phosphatase, stimulates activation of nucleus, nucleic factor of antigen transcription, of gene transcription. So activated NF-AT transcription factor moves into the nucleus, and here it stimulates gene transcription responsible for the synthesis of an interleukin-2. And I will remind you that interleukin-2 is the cytokine which is responsible for the development of cellular immunity. So if you use such drugs, they predominantly inhibit interleukin-2 synthesis, and thus they inhibit cellular immunity. Therapeutic uses of cyclosporin, the same about tacrolimus. This drug is used to prevent organ rejection in people who have received a liver, kidney, or heart transplant. You see, because of the selectivity of action on cellular immunity, this drug can't be used in the treatment of autoimmune disorders. And so there is no bone marrow suppression because cyclosporin doesn't inhibit B cells proliferation, humoral immunity. But still, this drug is toxic because it can cause nephrotoxicity, neurotoxicity, hepatotoxicity, hypertension, and hyperlipidemia. Now, sirolimus. So, if we are speaking about the mechanism of action of this drug, the target for their action is the mTOR, molecular target of rapamycin. Without the drug, interleukin-2 receptor signal transduction involves a complex set of protein-protein interactions that lead to increased translation of selected mRNAs, including proteins, required for T cell proliferation. T cell, it means cellular immunity. So interleukin-2 receptor activation initiates an intracellular signaling cascade that leads to phosphorylation of the molecular target of rapamycin. It means activation of this mTOR. mTOR is the enzyme, which is called kinase, that phosphorylates and thereby regulates the activity of other kinases. For example, first kinase inhibits the activity of one more factor that is required for translation. And so second kinase type phosphorylates proteins involved in protein synthesis. So the net effect of mTOR activation is to increase protein synthesis, thereby promoting the transition from G1 to S phase of the cell cycle. So if we use sirolimus, it stopped the cell cycle at on the phase of G1. So sirolimus crosses the plasma membrane and binds to intracellular FK binding protein, the same as tacrolimus. But then sirolimus FK binding protein complex inhibits mTOR, molecular target of rapamycin, and thereby inhibiting transition and causing T cells to arrest in G1 phase. So on this diagram, you can see these. So in general, again, it stops proliferation of T cells. It means inhibits cellular immunity. Then polyclonal antibodies, also antibodies against T lymphocytes. So they have predominant action on cellular immunity. These drugs are anti-thymocyte globulin. Thymoglobulin. It is a preparation of antibodies induced by injecting rabbits with human thymocytes. So the rabbit antibodies target many epitopes on human T cells, and this anti-thymocyte globulin is proved for use in acute renal transplant rejection. Because anti-thymocyte globulin targets essentially all T cells, so this anti-thymocyte globulin treatment can predispose to infection. So, thymoglobulin therapy is often complicated by fever and headache as prominent components of the cytokine release syndrome. This syndrome, common to many antibody drugs that target lymphocytes, results from activation of T cells and release of T cell cytokines before the antibody-coated T cells can be cleared by macrophages. So, predominant action of these polyclonal antibodies against T cell proliferation, so they predominantly inhibit cellular immunity. So that's why these drugs are also used to treat, to prevent organ rejection and organ transplantation. Basiliximab, monoclonal antibody, mab, the end means monoclonal antibody. So, this antibody against CD25 protein on the membrane of T lymphocytes. So, it has high affinity to interleukin 2 receptor. Interleukin 2, cytokine, not receptor, mediates early steps in T cell activation. It is administered prophylactically in renal transplantation to inhibit acute organ rejection. Also, basiliximab can be used as a component of general immunosuppressive regimens after organ transplantation. So, predominant inhibition of cellular immunity. Bortezomib, antibody-mediated rejection. Abbreviation AMR involves the production of high levels of antibodies by plasma cells against these organ cells that are used for transplantation, against the cells of transplant. Okay, so one mechanism to control antibody-mediated rejection is to target antibody production by plasma cells. So bortezomib is a protease inhibitor that leads to cell cycle arrest and apoptosis of normal plasma cells, so thereby decreasing antibody production in sensitized patients. So it is called protease inhibitor. It stops cell division, cycle arrest, plus it kills, destroys plasma cells. Plasma cells, the cells that that are responsible for the synthesis of antibodies against, for example, cells of organ transplant. So therapeutic uses of this drug: multiple myeloma, treatment of antibody-mediated rejection in transplant patients. Routes of administration: intravenous bolus or subcutaneous injection. Immunostimulating drugs. The major potential uses of such group of drugs is to treat immunodeficiency disorders or chronic infectious diseases, and also cancer. Immunostimulating drugs can be of exogenous origin. Such substances can't be produced inside the body. And of endogenous origin, when we use some agents that mimics the effect of endogenous substances or the drugs that stimulate endogenous production of endogenous substances that play major role in immunity. So, and third group of immunostimulating drugs are synthetic drugs. So drugs which of exogenous origin include vaccines and other microbial products that also have the same mechanism of formation of antibodies against the microbes that often cause infections. And so these drugs help the body to form immunity against such antigens, pathogens. So immunomodulators classification, exogenous, wait, 1 minute, it's mistake. Here must be, wow. Here must be an endogenous immunoregulatory peptides, thymic peptide drugs, thymolin, teactivin, cytokines, beta-leukin, aldesleukin, interferons, especially interferon gamma, thyaluron. These drugs stimulate production of interferons. And also for as immunomodulators, we can use immunoglobulins, normal human immunoglobulin, sandoglobulin. And you see in COVID-19, 2019, we also can use in severe cases the plasma of the treated patients in order to help in patients with a severe COVID pneumonia. Or you see, we can use to treat COVID-19, yeah, also exogenous vaccine. Synthetic immunomodulators, thymogen, and levamisole. Don't remember these groups of drugs. You see, I will eliminate them because they are very old. So immunostimulating drugs that you must remember will be microbial products. This is the vaccine that is used to produce immunity against tuberculosis. ERS-19 is a combination upper respiratory tract. Ribomunil is the ribosomes of bacteria that cause very often infections of upper respiratory tract. You can also add here bronchomunal, but in bronchomunal, in the capsules are also localized kills bacteria that often cause upper respiratory tract infections. Thymic peptides, thymosin alpha 1, recombinant cytokines, so we can use interferons in order to increase immunity of the patient. Interferon gamma 1b, interferon beta 1a, and interleukin 2. Or if it is severe immunodeficiency, we can use directly immunoglobulins, for example, sandoglobulin, synthetic drugs, levamisole. So vaccination or active immunization involves administration of an antigen, a skilled organism, attenuated organism, and also a specific protein or peptide or other constituents of microorganisms. You see, the same is the vaccine against COVID. Vaccines are considered to be the preparations obtained from microorganisms and their products and used for induction of a specific immune response, followed by formation of a long-term immunity against pathogen through production of memory cells. And don't forget that the formation of immunity can't provide the patient, the individual from infection. But if such individual meets infection, his immune system will defend such individual and it will be mild infection, not severe. So this is vaccine against tuberculosis, Bacillus Calmette Guerin, that's why it is called BCG. Is a viable attenuated strain of Mycobacterium bovis that has been used for immunization against tuberculosis. The principal target for BCG is the T cell. So it also stimulates, So it also stimulates natural killer cells, which are directed against malignant cells. Therefore, BCG is also active against tumors, you see, not only Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but also indicated for the treatment and prophylaxis of bladder cancer. So adverse effects include hypersensitivity. The most dangerous is the shock or anaphylactic shock, chills, fever, myalgias. IRS strains 19 is the standard lysate of an activated bacteria which commonly causes upper respiratory tract infections. It stimulates lysozyme and secretory immunoglobulin A production, and therefore increases local immune response. The preparation represents the dose needed aerosol for nasal administration. So convenient and common administration. Ribomunil contains ribosomes of bacteria which commonly cause respiratory tract infections. So you can start using this drug in autumn in order to form immunity before winter. In winter, for example, in Russia, especially in February, it is often the wave of influenza. So if the patients, the individuals are immunized, so it won't be very increased growth of such infections, for example, virus. The preparation stimulates both cellular and humoral immunity and also innate immune system. Because you see, commonly such drugs predominantly act on the adaptive immune system, but this drug also acts on the innate immune system. It is used for prophylaxis and treatment of recurrent respiratory tract infections by oral route. This is convenient route of administration. Allergic reactions are common adverse effects. Drugs which are of endogenous origin include thymic peptides, cytokines, and preparations of immunoglobulins. Thymic peptides have been isolated and purified from bovine and human thymus glands and promote T cells differentiation. The main preparation is thymosin. It consists of a group of peptides synthesized by the epithelioid component of the thymus. Thymosin has potential therapeutic application in T cell deficiency states. A recombinant peptide derived from this hormone is called thymosin alpha 1. So it induces increased production of interleukin 2. So, and it enhances the expression of interleukin 2 receptors on T cells. You see, the predominant action of this drug, thymosin alpha 1, is to stimulate cellular immunity. It has undergone clinical trials for the treatment of cancer and chronic active hepatitis. One more available preparation for the same usage to stimulate cellular immunity is thymodulin. Recombinant cytokines include preparations of interferons and interleukins. Interferons are known as alpha, beta, and gamma, which possesses antiviral and immunomodulatory activities of different degree. Okay, so preparations of interferon can be used for the treatment of serious infections associated with chronic granulomatose disease. And also interferon gamma 1b drug, it is recombinant drug, can cause fever, headache, rash, fatigue, gastrointestinal distress, anorexia, weight loss, myalgia, and depression as the adverse effect. Preparations of interferon beta, beta-1A and beta-1B are used for the treatment of relapsing multiple sclerosis to reduce the exacerbation of the disease. And also it can cause adverse effects, fever, chills, myalgia. Human recombinant interleukin 2, the trade name aldesleukin, is produced by recombinant DNA technology, differs from native interleukin 2 in some chemical groups. So this drug is used in patients with HIV, human immunodeficiency virus, and to augment specific anti-tumor immunity. Adverse effects, cardiovascular toxicity, including tachyarrhythmia resulting from loss of vascular tone and leak of plasma proteins and fluids into the extravascular space. Hypotension, reduced organ perfusion, and death may occur. Also, an increased risk of disseminating infection due to impaired neutrophil function. Synthetic drugs, levamisole was very popular in the treatment of helminthiasis such as ascariasis against Ascaridia. So, but after some time it was investigated that this drug also can stimulate immune response. So, levamisole restores depressed immune function of T cells, B cells, and macrophages. In immunodeficiency, this drug can increase the number of T cells. It has been used in treating of chronic infections. It also is used as an adjuvant treatment with fluorouracil in colorectal cancer. Its use has been associated with sometimes fatal agranulocytosis. So anti-inflammatory drugs, non-steroidal and steroidal glucocorticoids. So it must be also with the bold letters. And also in the brackets for you, I will put that these drugs are steroidal. Okay, so non-steroidal, steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, glucocorticoids, and also disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs. And in some situations, drugs which are used to treat gout also belong to anti-inflammatory drugs because the main symptom in gout is also inflammation. And we used the drugs which decrease inflammation. So glucocorticoids, what is this? Can be divided into systemic glucocorticoids. They can be used by oral administration or by parenteral administration. And glucocorticoids for local application. For example, for inhalation, you must remember one drug, beclomethasone. Of course, if you have good memory, you can remember also budesonide. For skin application, mometasone, fluocinolone, flumethasone, and clobetasol. And according of the names of such drugs, you can see that some of them starts from flu. It means fluoride. And this fluoride provides hydrophilicity for such drugs, and they can't cross cellular membranes. So that's why if we are speaking about prednisolone without fluoride, it easily crosses different membranes, including blood-brain barrier. So in the brain, prednisolone can cause psychosis, steroidal psychosis. In the periphery, it crosses different cellular barriers and produces so many serious adverse effects, severe adverse effects. And if you are speaking about glucocorticoids with fluoride in their structure, so this fluoride prevents their absorption, decrease cellular penetration, and that's why they act predominantly at the space of administration without causing systemic severe adverse effects. Mechanism of anti-inflammatory action of glucocorticoids. There are two mechanisms. The target for the action of corticosteroids are cytoplasmic receptors. So after binding with these receptors, this complex moves into the nucleus, and in the nucleus, corticosteroids stimulate gene transcription and cause the synthesis of protein, or inhibit gene transcription, and here will be inhibition of synthesis of COX-2. So, first mechanism, corticosteroids stimulate expression or synthesis due to gene transcription of lipocortin protein. That in turn inhibits the enzyme phospholipase A2. As a result, all these substances won't be synthesized, and especially pro-inflammatory prostaglandins, E2 and I2. Second mechanism of action, inhibition of expression or synthesis of COX-2. So COX-2, the enzyme which is synthesized in inflammatory area and only during inflammation. Without inflammation, everyday active is COX-1. So, and in the inflammatory area due to inhibition of COX-2, when to be the synthesis of pro-inflammatory mediators E2 and I2. Prednisolone, you must know this drug by heart because on the exam it will help you to get sleep. This drug can be used in different situations to treat autoimmune disorders, in organ transplantation to prevent graft rejection. It is used in bronchial asthma. So by itself, it has pronounced anti-inflammatory and immunosuppressive effects. As the adverse effects, it can cause the adrenal cortex insufficiency. It disrupts tissue regeneration. It causes osteoporosis. It increases glucose concentration in the blood. So these are side effects of prednisolone and other drugs which are used by oral or parenteral routes of administration. So I think that you remember such adverse effects from the previous semester. You see, redistribution of fat on the face, moon face, on the back. So buffalo hump on the abdomen, you see it will be large abdomen like in the pregnant women with the strias. Then thin extremities because of the catabolic effect on the proteins. Increased blood pressure and peripheral edema because of the mineralocorticoid activity. Thinning of the skin because of the catabolic effect on the proteins. Then steroidal psychosis, steroidal diabetes, increased glucose concentration because of the gastroprotective prostaglandin synthesis. These drugs can cause peptic ulcer, osteoporosis, obesity because of the increased appetite. So non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs can be divided into non-selective drugs that inhibit both COX-1 and COX-2 and selective that predominantly inhibit COX-2. So highly selective COX-2 inhibitor celecoxib, and in order to prevent ulceration, we can use non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs together with synthetic prostaglandin E1 analog, misoprostol. And in the middle position between inhibition of COX-1 and COX-2 are nimesulide, nabumetone, meloxicam. Therapeutic uses of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, you can see on this diagram. We can use their analgesic effect, anti-inflammatory effect, and antipyretic effect. So adverse effects of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, you can see on this diagram, but for me it's better to discuss with you adverse effects due to COX-1 inhibition. So let's speak about these adverse effects, but I will use this diagram. So non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs inhibit COX-1. As a result, these drugs inhibit prostaglandin synthesis, which possess gastroprotective function. As a result of this, it will be ulceration. First group of adverse effects due to COX-1 inhibition is the ulceration. So if you remember, in order to prevent this effect, we can use synthetic prostaglandin E1, misoprostol. Then second, because of cyclooxygenase pathway inhibition, it will be the activity of 5-lipoxygenase pathway of metabolism of arachidonic acid. So this pathway leads to formation of leukotrienes. Leukotriene B is responsible for chemotaxis and attraction of phagocytes. And for us, it's very important for side effects generation. Leukotriene C4, D4, E4, because these leukotrienes provide bronchoconstriction. So aspirin-induced asthma is the next side effect. According to inhibition of cyclooxygenase, it will be formation of thromboxane A2. As a result, it will be antiplatelet effect. So hemorrhage and bleeding. Prostaglandin E2 and I2 responsible for vasodilation and vascular permeability. So increased vasodilation in the kidney provides its normal function and filtration. So when we use cyclooxygenase inhibitors, it won't be the synthesis of such prostaglandins. So this effect will lead to renal insufficiency. What else? Prostaglandin E2 and F2 alpha stimulate myometrium contraction. So if we use non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs in pregnant women, and especially just before the labor, for example, to decrease body temperature, this provides decreased prostaglandin synthesis. So the situation can be dangerous because of the prolongation of the pregnancy, and this situation can be dangerous for the life of the woman and pregnant woman and for the baby. Okay, then prostaglandin F2 alpha stimulates spermatogenesis. So inhibition of cyclooxygenase 1 provides inhibition of spermatogenesis. That's all with the side effects of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs due to COX-1 inhibition. Some other side effects you can see on this diagram, including tinnitus, the problems with the hearing. Aspirin can't be used, or is better to say, should be avoided in patients less than 19 years old with viral infections. For example, varicella zoster infection or varicella simplex. Varicella zoster infection or influenza, it's also viral infection. So you will try to use aspirin to decrease body temperature in viral infections. But such patients will get Ray syndrome. This syndrome is characterized by fulminating hepatitis, cerebral edema, and these conditions are dangerous for life. Celecoxib, very selective COX-2 inhibitor. But if you remember, due to inhibition of COX-1, drugs can cause antiplatelet effect. This drug can't inhibit synthesis of thromboxane A2, so it provides increased thrombogenicity, thrombus formation. So, and that's why after usage of this drug can be risk of myocardial infarction or ischemic stroke. Classification of the drugs which can be used to treat allergy. In anaphylactic shock, the drug of first choice is epinephrine, I will remind you. Drugs which are used as anti-allergic drugs that block H1 histamine receptors, first generation is characterized by the crossing blood-brain barrier, and in the brain they block H1 histamine receptors, and all drugs that can block in the brain H1 histamine receptors or alpha adrenoceptors will lead to sedative or hypnotic effect. That's why first generation antihistamines distinguished feature is the short duration of action, about 4 hours to 6 hours, and second and third generation antihistamines long action, one time a day dosing. Also, first generation antihistamines due to penetration of blood-brain barrier and inhibiting H1 receptors in the brain will have predominant, pronounced sedative hypnotic effect. Second and third generation VAMP. So now distinguish differences between second and third generation. In general, you can divide all drugs into the first generation and second generation. In the second, you can put second generation and third generation drugs together. You can see that third generation antihistamines are active metabolites of desloratadine, cetirizine, levocetirizine, terfenadine, fexofenadine, and so on. So now let's speak about the mechanisms of action of different drugs, anti-inflammatory and immunodepressants. Here I already put you there, 1 minute. So tell me, first drug.